Hi everyone, this is Usha Pandit, your Mindsprings English teacher. If you are on my channel for the first time, please make sure that you subscribe and press the bell notification so that you get my videos as soon as I put them up. This is one more poetry video for grade 12. I've done a couple and you must go to my playlist and check them out. So Keeping Quiet by Pablo Neruda. Let's start right away. So the poet, Pablo Neruda, was a Chilean writer and poet, Nobel laureate 1971. He was a diplomat and considered one of the greatest modern poets. इस वीडियो में मैंने हरा में जो मैंने वर्ड्स लिखे हैं वो हिंदी में है ताकि जिन बच्चों को अंग्रेजी अच्छी तरह से नहीं आती हो वो बच्चे समझ पाए कि मीनिंग्स क्या है. ये एक है. दूसरा लाभ ये है कि जो बच्चे हिंदी अच्छी तरह से नहीं जानते वो सीख पाएंगे कि हिंदी के वर्ड्स क्या होते हैं और उनकी जो हिंदी के जो एसेज है उसमें बड़ा काम आएगा. सो इट्स ऑल अ विन विन. सो व्हाट दिस पोएम इज बेसिकली ट्राइंग टू टेल यू इज दैट अनलेस देयर इज अ कलेक्टिव पॉज, एक सामूहिक ठहराव, एक थमना, एक रुकना, इट विल नॉट गिव अस टाइम एंड अपॉर्चुनिटी टू रीथिंक आवर गोल्स एंड डेस्टिनेशंस. वी हैव बिकम ए सोसाइटी दैट इज ऑन द रन. वी आर कॉन्स्टेंटली रेस्टलेस एंड दैट इज वॉट द पोएट इज टॉकिंग अबाउट इन दिस पर्टिक्युलर पोएम. वी नीड एब्सोल्यूट स्टिलनेस. So when you are running, it is not possible for you to think clearly. What he is saying is stand still and only then will you find solutions to all the problems that are facing our modern world. We did get an opportunity to stand still because we had the coronavirus attack and that really paralyzed us and made us think about many things during this pandemic. So this of course was written much earlier and that this is exactly what the poet is saying. Stay still, sthirata, and be silent so that you are able to recognize our problems and predicament. We have a collective responsibility. Ek responsibility hai, ek uttardayitva hai jo hame, jiske liye hame khamoshi chahiye. Now What happens here is unless you use good words, you are not going to get very good marks. So that is the reason I put words like predicament, responsibility. These are excellent words for you to use when you are talking about this poem. We need collective reflection. Reflection is another good word. Reflection is when you think about all the things that have happened and all the things that you are responsible for. Atmanirakshan is what we say in Hindi for reflection. So basically the poet is saying, hey, wait a minute, stop and think about where are you going, what are you doing, and what's happening. So let's do the title check. This is what I always do with you guys. I tell you, check the title. So when you check the title, Keeping Quiet, what does it suggest to you? So first take the basic ideas that pop into your mind with a title. So you will find that keeping quiet means, it can mean doing nothing. It can mean being silent, which can be both positive and negative. So you can keep quiet and you can be neglectful, or you can keep quiet and you can be in a state of meditation. So it's positive and negative, right? Positive connotation is of course reflection, yoga, meditation, listening. Listening is very important. Most people don't know how to listen. So we talk and talk and talk and then we don't listen to other people. That's one of our problems. Pausing, viram. Pausing means don't constantly, if you're in a state of activity and agitation, you are then not able to reflect. So he says, pause, absorb, explore, self-explore, look at yourself and see what you are, look inwards, introspection. I'm just giving you many words and feeling. Now, when you do all this, you will have you will be able to feel the problems, and that is bhavana. So basically positive, all these are positive ways in which we can use silence and stillness. The negative connotations are inaction. Now we say keeping quiet, not doing anything, it can mean inaction, apathy, niturai, that is you don't care, indifference, to sin by silence, to turn away, to turn a Nelson's eye. Nelson's eye is a phrase that means to turn a blind eye. Basically, you are saying that you don't look at the problems of society, not face up to aggressive power, be cowardly. All of these are, you know, coming into the realm of negative connotations of keeping silent. So keeping silent or keeping quiet can be taken in two ways. And of course, not to speak up. When something wrong is happening around you, if you don't speak up, if you don't raise your voice, if you don't lend your voice, then that kind of silence is negative. So two things that pop into my mind when I look at the title. Now let's read the poem. Keeping Quiet by Pablo Neruda, the poem. Now we will count to 12 and we will all keep still for once on the face of the earth. Let's not speak in any language. Let's stop for a second and not move our arms so much. It would be an exotic moment. Without rush, without engines, we would all be together in a sudden strangeness. Fishermen in the cold sea would not harm whales, and the man gathering salt would not look at his hurt hands. Those who prepare green wars, wars of gas, wars with fire, victories with no survivors, would put on clean clothes and walk about with their brothers in the shade, doing nothing. What I want should not be confused with total inactivity. Life is what it is about. If we were not so single-minded about keeping our lives moving and for once could do nothing, perhaps a huge silence might interrupt the sadness of never understanding ourselves or of threatening ourselves with death. Now I'll count up to 12 and you keep quiet and I will go. So this is the poem. Some of you will say we didn't understand much, and some of you will say we understood a little bit because you told us it's about keeping quiet and solving problems. And what I would say to you is, can you see, if you just look around this poem, you'll see many problems are sitting in these words. So the red words are the negative word cluster, all the negative words that you find in a poem, and the blue ones are the silent clusters. They're showing maybe peace, maybe silence, that kind of thing. So basically, when you get a poem, look at the title and then look at word clusters. What are the negative words? What are the positive words? This is the way you appreciate a poem. Okay. So keeping quiet by, now we'll do it stanza by stanza. So I'm going to take stanza 1 and 2. And if you read it and you see these pictures that I have put at the side, you will find that the pictures seem to reflect what is there. So now we will count to 12. 12, as you know, is a magical number, right? So there are a lot of things that are, you have 12 months of the year, and then you have, in many mythologies, you have 12 gods and several, the number 12 is associated with a lot of good stuff also. So count up to 12. And of course, your clock itself is divided into 12 hours for the day and 12 hours of PM for the night. So you've got a lot of connotations of 12 there. And we will all keep still. So he says, it's an imagination. Imagine if the whole world just kept still. The silence, the stillness that would exist. For once on the face of the earth. Once, just keep still. Let's not speak in any language. And let's stop for a second and not move our arms so much. So if you look at the pictures, if you look at that train there, just look at the activity, just look at the rush, and you'll find that people are talking all the time. So there is so much, so many languages on earth, and therefore so much of misunderstanding. So you look at the pictures very carefully, you will see, and the stillness, this picture here is a still moment. The last one there shows complete stillness, where everyone is just standing still. So that's your first and second stanza. Now let's see what are the devices in this. This is a difficult poem because there are a lot of figures of speech, a lot of devices in this poem, and we are going to take a look at it. 12 seconds to count, a short time to prepare for science. So 12 seconds is like so quick, isn't it? So it's just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. That's it. That's 12 seconds. And then you have to prepare for that science. We do not have much time left. It's also about urgency. You don't have a lot of time to sit and count. You have to count very fast because the urgency is so great. Because we are already very, very badly hurt. Languages are symbolic, as I said, of the noise, of the multiple cultures and countries and opinions and disagreements and fights that are happening because of different races and different sections of people who don't seem to be seeing eye to eye. So there's a lot of division in us. I think that's why he says, stop the languages, because stop the division. A second. Just for a second, and a second is actually what we call a hyperbole. So language there was symbolic, and a second here is hyperbole. Hyperbole is an exaggeration. So he doesn't mean for a second, obviously 1 second, he means a little more, like a short time, but the exaggeration there is in that word second. Arms. So when he talks about arms, when he says, and not move our arms so much, what he's basically trying to say is, one is arms. So when you're talking, you gesture a lot, or you fight with your arms, or you show a lot of energy and anger can be shown with your arms. Arms, the flame, talking so aggressively, or it can mean arms as in weapons. Don't move your arms, don't go for wars. So agitation, fighting, frenzy. I've given you again lots of words that you can use. Exotic is rare, unusual, extraordinary, precious. So it would be an exotic moment. That moment when everything is still is one of those very precious moments which you will not get again. Never felt or seen before. Togetherness, when he talks of togetherness, what he means is the unity that is lost. So he says it will be a sudden strangeness when we all come together and everything is silent. It will be strange, isn't it? Because imagine for a moment everything silent. That would be very, very strange. And yet, togetherness, unity. So unity that is lost to sound can be regained in total silence. Right now, the unity is lost because of all the sound. And if we keep silent, we might actually come together, right? And introspect and start thinking about who are we, where are we going, why are we divided? We can ask these questions. A sudden strangeness is an alliteration because you've got sa and sa, stra actually. Not quite an alliteration, but maybe a sort of alliteration there. It is unexpected. Sudden strangeness is like an unexpected thing. You don't expect a sudden strangeness like that to come in. Togetherness is ekta, and strangeness is vichitrata. So you've got two things coming in there. It's almost what we call a paradox. So where you are talking about sudden, which is a togetherness and a strangeness, both of these coming together in a couple of lines, and that is where you have a paradox or what we call an antithesis. So we would all be together in a sudden strangeness. So all be together, and then strangeness is a stranger, for example, is somebody you don't know, and that is hardly together. So you got two contrasting ideas sitting in those lines. A repetition is called anaphora, and it is marked in red. So if you see all the red stuff that is there in that stanza, we will, let's not speak, let's stop, not move. It would be without rush, without engine. See this repetition, would, will, that repetition is called anaphora. And I've marked those in red, and it continues into the next stanza. So it's a very simple thing he's asking for, but the meaning is so profound, so deep. Right. Now let's come to stanza 3. Fishermen in the cold sea would not harm whales. So there is a what we call a whaling expedition. Whaling is this big fish, one of the biggest fish in the sea, is caught and used for various things like its skin and its flesh and its oil. And they are killed, mercilessly killed. So fishermen in the cold sea, if everything is silent, then for 1 minute, everyone is going to stop. Or even for a second, everybody will stop. And those poor whales will not die, because fishermen will also stop working. And the man gathering salt. So if you look at this, this is a sea imagery. From the sea, you get fish. And from the sea, you get salt. And the man gathering salt would look at his hurt hands. So when you gather salt, see that salt hands there. Salt will, even if you walk in the seawater, all your skin gets extremely crumpled. So imagine people working with salt will be having cuts on their fingers. So they're hurt hands. One is literal, it is hurt hand. But when you go on taking salt out of the sea, as they do, then there is also a hurting of the sea. So there are two things that are running together. So you look at these pictures again, and you will find that there is a certain poverty that comes in because of the way in which we treat the earth. Okay, so that's your third stanza. Now, in the third stanza, if you want to look at the devices, as I told you, this poem is full of devices. You'll find harm whales, the silence and ceasing of activity will make sure that the fishermen will halt their whaling expeditions. That is Joe. तिमिंगल है द वेल इज दिस बिग वन जो बड़ी मछली है उसका जो शोषण करते हैं दैट विल कम टू एन एंड दैट विल स्टॉप अ रेयर मोमेंट अगेन सी फॉर वन सिंगल मोमेंट यू हैव स्पेयर्ड द वेल फ्रॉम गेटिंग किल्ड सो इट्स क्वाइट क्वाइट इंटरेस्टिंग देन यू हैव द एनाफोरा कंटिन्यू फ्रॉम द सेकंड स्टैंजा दैट वुड नॉट हार्म आई टोल्ड यू दैट इज कंटिन्यूइंग हियर वुड नॉट हार्म वुड लुक हर्ट Symbolically, both fisherman and whale are symbolic. So who is the fisherman? The fisherman represents all man, and the whale represents the animal kingdom, isn't it? So the all animals that are subject to exploitation, and the fisherman is the man who exploits all animals. So you've got man's role in exploiting nature. Hurt hands, man exploits nature's resources, and man is the oppressor. So he's also talking about how oppression will stop for a second. For 1 second, nobody will oppress anybody, and the animals will be spared. The hands that inflict hurt on the sea is described as a transferred epithet. So this is, the hands are actually hurting the sea, but when you transfer the hurt onto the hands, it is called a transferred epithet in hurt hand. So there are two ways to look at it. One is that the hand is hurt by all that we do, like the salt panning that is done on the sea. But if you look at it as a sea metaphor, that sea is all of nature and we are hurting the sea, then it's not the hand that is hurt, the hand is hurting. But here the poet has described it as hurt hands. It's brilliant. It's kind of layering. You've got hurt hands and then you've got hurting hands. So that's kind of comes together in a sort of a, again, a strange unity that he talks about. This also shows you the exploitation comes back to hurt us. So one way of looking at it is when you hurt, you will also get hurt, which is very true. If you are going to hurt animals, it's going to affect your environment. it's going to affect your climate, it's going to affect you, and you will ultimately get some disease, or you will have several problems like water problems and pollution problems, and you are going to be hurt. So that's why I think that alliteration is also there. His hurt hands, ha ha ha. And you have all these things coming together, these devices that are knotted up together in this very small stanza. But see how much complication is there. So it's very, very clever. Stanza four of Keeping Quiet is, those who prepare green wars of gas, wars of fire, victories with no survivors. So some victories, there's nobody survives. Everybody is a loser in some wars. It's called a Pyrrhic victory. There I've put the word down for you, and that might be something that we will talk about in the next slide. Would put clean clothes and walk about with their brothers in the shade doing nothing. So all these are your problems, see? You've got wars and you've got bombs and you've got the coronavirus, everything there. So this is how the world is today. So anaphora is continued again. You will find would put on in this. So see that would put on, would take, would give, that is constantly there, and that's an anaphora. Wars is also anaphoric, green wars, wars with gas, wars with fire, wars, that is repeated. And what is that? So you have the green wars, which are the biological weapons, which means created from plant life, maybe, or from germs, right? Living matter. And then you have wars of gas, which is your chemical weapons. And you have wars of fire, which is your nuclear weapons. So all sorts of wars that are taking place in the world, they have no survivors. Because when you say biological weapon, and you say chemical weapon, and you say nuclear weapon, it kills everybody. In the end, it is going to kill every single person on earth. And it's going to damage the environment for a long, long time. So therefore, basically, we are saying that it's a Pyrrhic victory, a victory where there are no winners. Everybody is a loser. So a Pyrrhic victory is one where you lose more than you win. For example, suppose you are fighting for a certain land that is worth, let us say, 2 lakhs. And you go and spend fees on a lawyer that is worth 2.5 lakhs. And you might win the land, but in the end, you have lost more money than you won, isn't it? So in a war, if you have lost, let us say, 80% of your soldiers and you have won the war, it's what we call a Pyrrhic victory, because there's nothing to celebrate. You have lost 80% of your soldiers. And what is the point in saying you won the war? So it's like that. All these wars are eventually going to make humanity lose. And therefore, that victory is ironic. Okay, so this is something to remember. Clean clothes. So men could walk about in clean clothes. Here means clothes that have no blood on them. Clean clothes there is an alliteration. It's also a metonymy. Metonymy is where you take a small part and then it describes something much bigger. So therefore, you are going to stop, basically saying clean clothes will stop bloodshed, and it's symbolic of a change of heart. People will not kill. People will not wage wars. Brothers in the shade, they'll walk like brothers in the shade. Formerly they were enemies. Now you forgive, you walk around together. Imagine if the whole world walked in brotherhood, how wonderful it would be. So talking about peace, right? Shade again is a metaphor. So you've got this sunlight that hurts you, and then you have the shade which gives you comfort. Peace gives you comfort. Opposed to scorching war, it also is about idyllic bonding, harmony, caring. All of these words can be used for that metaphor of shade. Doing nothing, simply enjoying the peace. We were meant to be peaceful. We were meant to be helping one another. We were meant to be eating everything that is there in the trees and living healthy, happy lives, doing nothing. Right now, we are agitating, we are struggling, we are running. That is something that needs to stop. Stanza 5, the last one. What I want should not be confused. No, I think it's a penultimate one. What I want should not be confused with total inactivity. Now, some people say doing nothing means, oh, don't do anything. Just sit there and do nothing. No, he says it's not that. Life is what it is about. I'm not talking about inactivity, which means death. I'm talking about life. I want no truck with death. I've got nothing to do with death. If we were not so single-minded about keeping our lives moving, single-minded, obsessive, everyone is running. Moving. As they say, running to be in the same place. Have you heard that? That means if you want to stay in the same place, you have to keep running. If you don't keep running, then you can't even stay in the same place. That kind of thing. So it's become like that. We have brought it upon ourselves. And for once, do nothing. Please be peaceful, right? And perhaps a huge silence might interrupt this sadness. For the first time, he's using the sadness of never understanding ourselves. What is sad is that we don't understand who we are. And of threatening ourselves with death. All the time we are living on the edge of death. And who is doing it? We are doing it. It's like almost taking a knife to yourself. So you are the one threatening yourself all the time that anytime I might cut myself. It's that kind of a state. Suicidal, right? And if you look at these pictures again, you will find the kind of misery that we are talking about in the world. So now let's come to the notes and devices. What I want should not be confused with total inactivity. Inactivity there is death. So when you are dead, then of course there is no activity. The poet warns of possible confusion. And he says, don't mistake what I'm saying for death. I'm talking about life. The poem is about giving life a chance, not about dying. I want no truck. I really don't have anything to do with death. What we need is a huge silence so that we can continue to live. Single-minded is stubborn. I've given you lots of words, rigid, inflexible. So if you don't say, if you don't agree, you say this is the way we are going to be, then of course there is no hope. Hedonism is where you want everything for yourself. Greed. You are only interested in your pleasure. That is hedonism. For once, a desperate plea. Please, he's almost begging you to silence and to pause and to introspect. Incessant human activity has created chaos. Sadness is the result. The sadness of hurt, pain, dysfunction, disconnected. See how many words I'm giving you. Melancholy, loss, all of this is what has come because of our movement, constant movement. Never understanding. Humans have no self-analysis. And threatening ourselves with death is we are not threatening other creatures. We might think we are killing other things, but no, it will come back and hit us. Ironically, by killing other creatures, we are actually killing ourselves. By killing our planet, by killing our seas and our mountains and our forests, we are killing ourselves. So that's what he's talking about, the irony of it. In our rush to live better, we are actually killing ourselves. So we are the endangered. Hum khatre mein hai. Not the ones whom we are putting into danger or destroying. So this is the big irony in this whole piece. So as you can see, it's very complex and it's very beautiful. I mean, it's very clever the way he has made this poem. The last stanza is perhaps the earth can teach us. As when everything seems dead and later proves to be alive. Now I'll count up to 12 and you keep quiet and I will go. So you look at this pictures, guys, you'll find that in the snow or in the rocks or in the in places where there is a huge kind of famine or in the sands, where there's no rainfall, everywhere you will find that you'll find life coming up. So you'll think it's dead, but you'll suddenly look, you'll find grass, you'll find flowers, you'll find from that snow, you will find greenery coming out. That is the earth teaching you that even though everything looks dead, there is actually life happening all the time. There is renewal. So the notes for this is the earth can teach us as a silent teacher. The earth is a silent teacher, it's a personification. It is still and yet it is full of latent life. Latent means one that is not awake completely, but which is just below the surface. There's a productive energy, there's an activity, that seeming and being. So it might seem like it's dead, but it's actually alive. Perception versus reality. You've got a lot of contrasts in this. It might look like that, but it is not. It might seem like that, but it's actually alive. So dead and living coming together, sitting together, and life sitting inside the cloak of death. That's what you see here. So nothing is lost. Nothing is going to happen to you if you stop for a minute. The silent performer, like the earth will teach you. Don't worry, everything will come back again and will come to life. The resilience is a very important thing, and that earth is a symbol of resilience, of renewal, repair, rejuvenation. Again, I've given you lots of words. It's a very powerful cyclical thing. Everything is cyclical, up and down, good and bad, disaster and renewal. It's a constant cycle. The earth is showing you that. So you don't have to worry. Even if you're feeling down, you will bounce back. Everything that seems dead and later proves to be alive is an antithesis. The earth's productivity is our hope. We must learn from earth's patience, optimism, generosity, to nurture and to be givers. So that's very important. You have to learn to nurture. The earth nurtures all of us, gives us everything that is there on the earth is what we use to nurture our own bodies and our souls in every way. So it says learn from the earth. A moment of silence to realize the wisdom of the silent earth versus all the human talk. To begin to feel without the intrusion of words. To experience tranquility, peace, and brotherhood. These are the big messages there, right? I will go. That I will go means my work is done. I'm going. I'm going to count up to 12 for you. I'll do that for you. And you pause and you think. That's what he says. Let time stand still so that all of you can reevaluate and you can see what is your purpose, what are your actions. You can reassess your bonds and renew yourselves. It is the poet's last shot, convincing his fellow men to embrace peace. So it's all about peace. It's about silence. It's about wisdom. It's about thinking, where are we going? This is what this poem is about. Themes that are linked to this picture. So I wanted to look at the themes. So if you look at this, you'll find that you are in the center there, at peace, see? If you sit still, and then all around you, right now, all around you, you've got all of this happening. This is a very powerful picture. You've got death of animals, oil spills, nuclear bombs, floods, bushfires, drought, garbage, polar bears who are in trouble. Every place man has been killing. Man needs to sit in this posture still. Man needs to stop so that all of what we have done, we are able to understand. And from then on, we are able to make some resolutions that we are going to live better lives. So this is what this poem is about. There are a few quotations that I have taken from Eckhart Tolle and Armstrong and Deepak Chopra, which might come in handy, especially if you have a new pattern of paper and they give you some quotations and ask you to talk about the poem, then these might well be some of those quotations that you will find useful to know yourself as being beneath the thinker. The stillness under the mental noise, the love and joy under the pain is freedom, salvation, enlightenment. Or be still, stillness reveals the secrets of eternity. So it's all about the good stuff about being still and reflecting. So I hope you enjoyed this poem. I've given you so many words. And as I said, for the Hindi speaking people, the translations are there in green. And if you use some of those words and answer your question, and talk about the theme and talk about the link to modern life, to what the kind of problems we have around us, I think you'll get brilliant marks. So once again, subscribe to the channel, tell your friends about it, tell them I'm doing the grade 12 poetry here and get them to watch. So until we meet again, keep smiling.